After 3 years of construction, as well as persistent speculation and skepticism from scholars and museum experts, the Museum of the Bible is set to open its doors on Friday. The new museum is situated in a renovated brick warehouse, 3 blocks from the National Mall and the U.S. Capitol Building. But unlike the many Smithsonian institutions nearby, the Museum of the Bible will be dedicated to exploring one book's history and impact across the globe. The existence of the privately funded museum can be largely credited to Steve Green, the CEO of the craft store chain Hobby Lobby. Green is an evangelical Christian and a proponent of conservative causes. In 2014, Hobby Lobby was involved in a Supreme Court battle over whether family-owned corporations were required to provide free contraception to employees under the Affordable Care Act. The court ruled in favor of Hobby Lobby, citing the company's right to religious freedom. While the majority of the museum's board members are white, male, and evangelical, museum officials maintain that the museum does not support one religious viewpoint above others. "We want to be able to host and be a platform for discussion of various faith traditions, various people coming from different cultural positions, as well as secular viewpoints," said Seth Pollinger, the museum's director of content. An arcade-style game with a biblical theme from the children's area of the museum. Michaela Lefrak Wamu. Part of the impact of the Bible exhibit, featuring a section on the Bible's role in the civil rights movement. Michaela Lefrak Wamu. A recreation of a traditional home and meal in Nazareth, the village where Jesus grew up. Michaela Lefrak Wamu. A medieval Bible, from the history of the Bible exhibit. Michaela Lefrak Wamu. The entrance to Washington Revelations, an immersive exhibit that gives visitors a flying tour of Washington sites. Michaela Lefrak Wamu. The children's area of the museum, called TKTEK. Michaela Lefrak Wamu. An arcade-style game with a biblical theme, from the children's area of the museum. Michaela Lefrak Wamu. Part of the impact of the Bible exhibit, featuring a section on the Bible's role in the civil rights movement. Michaela Lefrak Wamu. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. What's inside? The 430,000-square-foot museum cost around $500 million to build. The investment is evident in the high-tech displays, theme park-style interactive exhibits, and elaborately designed event spaces that are spread throughout the museum's 8 floors. Walking up to the museum, a visitor is first greeted by 2 40-foot-tall bronze recreations of Gutenberg Bible pages that flank the entrance doors. "The goal," said a spokeswoman for a PR firm working with the museum, "is to turn the Gutenberg gates into a cultural touchstone, similar to the lions outside the New York Public Library." The gates already have their own Twitter handle. Just inside, a 140-foot-long digital projection displays colorful biblical images on the lobby ceiling. As a visitor checks in at the main desk, he or she will be invited to use a handheld digital guide. The device can be personalized based on the visitor's expected length of stay, monitor traffic flow within the exhibits, and direct visitors towards areas with smaller crowds. Seth Pollinger, the director of content at the Museum of the Bible. Michaela Lefrak Wamu. There are 3 main exhibit floors that cover the impact, stories, and history of the Bible. The curators employ technology throughout, including a ride called Washington Revelations that takes visitors on a simulated flight through D.C. There is also a recreation of Nazareth, Jesus' hometown, that visitors can walk through and interact with 3 actors in period garb. "One of our goals is really to set up immersive environments where people can put themselves in the center of the story," said Pollinger, as he pointed out a screen displaying an abstract film that resembled the inside of a kaleidoscope. The artist, he said, was inspired by the Tree of Life from the Garden of Eden. An arcade room aimed at children features Bible-inspired games, include one where kids can use a slingshot to shoot a rock through a hole in a painting of Goliath's head, like David did. Up on the top floor, the museum's cafeteria-style restaurant, Manna, will feature Mediterranean-inspired dishes, such as a falafel sandwich on rye. It will be run by Chef Todd Gray of the DC restaurant Equinox. There will also be a biblical garden with plants from the Mediterranean. What's absent? The exhibits manage to cover a wide breadth of history, including stories from both the Old and New Testament, the Bible's metamorphosis from an oral to a written tradition, and the book's influence on both the abolition and pro-slavery movements. However, certain controversial topics are noticeably absent. There's nothing on the Crusades, the Inquisition, or abortion and gay rights. Most people expect that museums will represent a disinterested, objective, well-informed, scholarly approach to whatever it is being put on display, said Neil Harris, a museum expert and author of the book Capital Culture, J. Carter Brown, the National Gallery of Art, and the Reinvention of the Museum Experience. It's not that religion does not enter into American museums, it's that this museum may be presenting from a specific angle. Pollinger insists that there isn't one right way to interpret the Bible, and says the staff took pain to collaborate with a diverse array of experts, from an African-American working group to a group of Israeli scholars. The museum has even amassed the world's largest collection of Torahs. But many scholars have questioned whether the museum's collection is entirely authentic. Over the summer, Hobby Lobby had to pay a $3 million fine and forfeited thousands of ancient artifacts that had been smuggled out of Iraq. Museum officials say their collection is legally separate from Hobby Lobby's, though experts still question why all of the objects' provenance has not been fully cataloged online. Museums represent authority, said Harris, who did not want to comment directly on the Museum of the Bible's collection, as he has not yet visited the museum. How the Museum of the Bible will fit into this community remains to be seen. It's going to be rather interesting. The museum could bring a new audience to the mall, as well. We've already seen a lot of interest from businesses that want to book meetings in the state-of-the-art space, said Elliot Ferguson, president and CEO of the tourism group Destination DC. A museum representative declined to comment on the exact number of visitors the museum expects on opening weekend, but said they expect millions of people to visit this museum about the world's most influential book over the first several years. For those interested in visiting, the museum will be free to enter, though certain special exhibits do require paid tickets. Timed entry tickets are booked through the weekend, though there are still slots available for next week.